And aging is in general characterized by a functional decline at all levels, at the level of the cells, at the level of the organ, and at the level of the whole body. Now, this functional decline can be tolerated, starts rather early in our life, but it can be tolerated and compensated for a long time. But with increasing age, it becomes more and more problematic. And then it also facilitates the onset of so-called aging-associated diseases. And finally, it adds, it ends up in a complete collapse of the system. The goal is really to understand what drives or what is the reason for this functional decline, to delay it and therefore delay the onset of age-associated diseases and increase the healthy lifespan. That's basically the goal that we are following up. Research area one deals with processes that occur in a cell and that maintain its functionality. And these processes are declining with age, so we know that these processes are functionally impaired, they don't work so well anymore in the age, in the elderly, and we try to understand why is that, which mechanisms basically try to prevent it, or how can we prevent it in order to maintain the function of a cell in the elderly.
As we started understanding the structure of cells, we have started understanding the different parts of cell can also contribute to aging. So we have a DNA that's basically a matrix that holds all the informations, and if you have problems with this matrix, then you will have problems with obviously with aging. Then within this single cell you have a lot of other structures called organelles, and one of those is seems to be very important to general well-being of cell, and this is mitochondria. They're usually called power plants of the cell because they produce all the energy that needs to be produced for the cell. But it's not perfect and it makes mistakes, and these mistakes are oxidants. And these oxidants are recognized for a very long time as a possible driver of aging. And therefore, mitochondria were put in the kind of center of also aging, why aging would be important.
Various processes have been identified to be critical during the aging process. These include proteostasis mechanisms, or protein homeostasis in a cell, organellar function, DNA damage response, the function of stem cells, inflammatory responses, so various characteristic processes in the cells that are studied by various groups within the consortium. And a special focus now is, as it has been recognized that many of these processes are interdependent, so they really influence each other, to really understand how this functional interdependence occurs and what's the role of this during the functional decline during the aging process.
This function in mitochondria has been connected very strongly with Parkinson's disease, with Alzheimer's disease, and other type of neurodegenerative diseases. And we obviously know that this function is connected also with sarcopenia, and that means loss of muscle mass, that is also common for the aging process, and also the heart changes in heart cardiomyopathies, and that also are common with increasing age, are also connected with mitochondrial dysfunction. So basically, mitochondria are almost always connected with the tissues where you need a lot of energy production. Our aim is to, of course, understand much more the basic mechanisms behind this. And what we have already done is to make, for example, models where we can increase the number of mitochondrial DNA mutations and then show that this actually causes accelerating aging. And this was very, very important and very good for us because that was a kind of a starting point. So now, the point what we would like to understand is why a general increase in mutations give you specific kind of strong phenotype in certain cells but not in the others. Also, what is the tissue specificity of this process, because this is what we don't understand, both in pure mitochondrial diseases and in the aging process. What we have also done is the work that kind of disputed a bit the whole involvement on oxidant and antioxidant in this process, because it became obvious over the last 10 years or so that not all oxidants produced within the cells are actually bad. They are very important for signaling and we should not completely kind of get rid of them.
And it is known that protein function declines with age. Proteins form three-dimensional folded structures, and this folding is impaired. So there is a lot of protein misfolding, protein aggregation occurring during aging, which I think is very prevalent in a number of neurodegenerative disorders like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease that are characterized by the deposition of plaques, which reflect misfolded aggregated proteins. And groups interested in proteostasis really try to understand the mechanism that either prevent the formation of these protein aggregates, this protein misfolding, disturbance of proteostasis, or basically which help to recover from it. So first of all, we are interested in the aging of humans, of course. But I mean, as we all agree, is this is not an experimentable, accessible model organism, and we can only basically describe what happens in the elderly, but we cannot intervene with it, and therefore it's difficult from a scientific point of view to really untangle what are really cause and consequences and what is really the reason for what we see then. So we can only describe it, but to really understand it mechanistically, you need simpler systems that you can manipulate, you can genetically manipulate, you can apply biochemical methods to basically characterize fundamental processes that may also occur in a much complex, more complex system, but you cannot experimentally access it for various reasons, technical reasons, ethical reasons, and so on and so forth. And therefore, we focus our work on model organisms. And worm is one example, which is for model organisms that is genetically very accessible and has been used very successful in early studies in the aging field to understand, to identify fundamental or central processes that are linked, signal cascades that are basically linked to the aging process and determine longevity.
And we also very often use kind of a systemic approach. That means that we look at all global changes without thinking of what would be our possible favorite change. So basically, you look at general changes and then you pick up what is the important from there. And for this, we have a great help for all the different facilities that are here built up within CECAT.
The detailed understanding of these fundamental mechanisms will point to new targets that basically are recognized to be critical for this functional decline and offer then the possibility to intervene. And I think that's contribution that these fundamental studies can give to basically our understanding of the aging process, but then also for the society, because then one can build on this understanding and then identify basically or think of new therapeutic interventions that may be possible to basically help to prevent the onset of age-associated diseases, for instance.
So I do think we are on the right path, and I do think that aging, looking at the aging as a general change for diseases that are connected with simple kind of individual organs is the way of kind of curing things on the larger scale. But I think we have to kind of do it very step by step and still learn a lot more about the process.
Because the problem of the aging process is its complexity, and you may basically target one process, but this may have negative effects on other processes. So therefore, it's important to look at it in the whole complexity, and therefore it's very important to work in a consortium with many different groups working, addressing many different questions associated with the aging process, because this offers them the possibility to have a more integrative view on the whole process.
I think this is a freedom and excitement about new things, constantly new things. This is for me the two most important parts of my work that I really like.
I'm fascinated by the possibility to think about a problem, to address a problem with relatively simple measures in relatively simple systems, like for instance in a model organisms, and then understand the fundamental principle that then helps and to contributes at least to our understanding of a very complex phenomenon like the aging process. And this is, as I always say, not always simple, but it's actually always exciting.